now that the snow is gone.
Yeah.
I'm always afraid of letting people go out there in the snow. Just because it's like makes a mess out there, I can get out there and So now that it's a little less muddy, you can go out and go out there.
That's a lot of work.
I've seen y'all get on track. Yeah. 20 of them in my yard and all play and everything.
Yeah, no. Yeah, no, I don't think Zumba doesn't have like a, yeah, so our dog is Zumba. But she doesn't have any of that bone in her body. Like if you want to rub her head, she'd all the worst. She'd be the worst our dog.
Let's begin with our call to worship. Jesus went to the mountaintop to pray.
Jesus went to the city to heal.
Jesus walked to Samaria to extend love.
Jesus went to the water's edge to teach.
Jesus went to places of peace and connection.
But Jesus also went to the wilderness
There is nowhere we can go that God does not walk with us.
We are in God's house. Let us worship Holy God.
Please rise as you are able.
Worship a God who invites us into a richer faith, a deeper love, a more compassionate existence with a million chances to try again. So let us speak truth into our lives, asking for God's help where we need it. Let us pray our prayer of confession together.
Amen.
Holy God, when we think that expansive life is about power, teach us to be willing.
Gracious Creator, when we think that expansive life is about material wealth, Gracious Author, when we think that expansive life is about control,
teach us a new way.
Teach us to live as you live.
Teach us to love as you love.
Forgive us when we don't.
Gratefully we pray. Amen.
Siblings in Christ, no matter how many times we mess up, no matter how far we wander, no matter how lost we feel, God's grace is full to the brim. It overflows in desert places. It finds us where we are, and it covers us in mercy. Hear and believe this good news. God's love is overflowing. We are drenched in mercy. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Let us pray. God of the wilderness, places in our lives.
It can be hard to hear you in the desert. It can be hard to hear you in the city, in the midst of our calendar reminders, rush hour traffic, and notification alerts. It can be hard to hear you, so we ask, make everything quiet. Pause the chaos, still the rushing, ease our racing thoughts. Give us ears to hear your word for us today, which promises that even in the desert, you are full to the brim. We are listening. We ache for your good news. Gratefully we pray. Amen.
I invite our children and those who are young at heart who'd like to join the children to come forward for a children's message that you have.
And while he was there, the devil tried to tempt Jesus. Does anyone know what it means to tempt someone or to be tempted? Brady, do you know?
To try to persuade someone to do something.
Yeah, it's usually something you shouldn't do, right? So in this story, the devil is trying to tempt Jesus three times. So I brought little items to kind of help us remember what the temptations were, okay? So here's our first item. What is it?
A rock.
It's a rock. Because the devil tried to tempt Jesus to turn this rock into bread. Because remember, he was really hungry. He was there for 40 days. But Jesus said, no, I know that's not the right choice, so I'm not going to listen to the devil. So that was the first temptation. And I had to be creative with some of these.
A superhero!
Yeah! So our second one is a superhero cape. And it kind of represents being powerful, right? Because the devil said, okay, if you worship me, I will make you the most powerful being in the whole world. What do you think Jesus said?
No.
He said, no. I know you should only worship God, so I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to listen to you. And then the third time, what is this?
The house.
It's a little house or a building. Because the devil said, yes, you're right. Because the devil said, you know what? If you think your God is going to protect you no matter what, why don't you go to the top of that building and jump off and see if God can protect you? What do you think Jesus said?
No.
No. He said, I know that the Bible says that we should never test God. So there were three times, he said, when he was trying to tell him to change the rock into bread, when he was trying to get him to worship him, and He was trying to get him to test God by jumping up off the building. But Jesus knew what the Bible said, and he said no to all of those. Have you ever been tempted to make a bad choice? Yeah. Sometimes at home, sometimes maybe at school. How does it feel when you make a bad choice? Yeah, sometimes you feel sad or guilty afterwards. Now, Jesus, he used the Bible to help him make good choices. What or who do you use to make good choices? What or who helps you make good choices? Yeah, Linnea?
My mom.
Yes, sometimes your parents give you wise advice so you can make good choices. Who else helps you make good choices? Great. Teachers. So those are the people we should listen to. Yeah.
Sometimes yourself.
Yeah, you said, I've already learned about this, and I know what a good choice is. Yes.
And
God. And just like
scared.
Just like in our story, Jesus used the Bible to help make good choices, right? Alright, so this week I want you to think about not only about making good choices, but how God was with Jesus the whole time he was in the desert. So just like God was with Jesus, God is with us all the time too. What was that? I was wondering that same question. Why was there a building in the desert? Maybe we can ask Pastor Jenna.
Reading is from Romans chapter 10. The word is near you, on your lips and in your heart. That is the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For one believes with the heart and so is justified, and one confesses with the mouth and so is saved. The scripture says, no one who believes in him will be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. The same Lord is Lord of all, and is generous to all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I invite you to please stand as you are able for the Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 4th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit in the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing at all during those 40 days, and when they were over, he was famished. The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command this stone to be turned to a loaf of bread." And Jesus answered him, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone, Then the devil led him up and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And the devil said to him, "To you I will give their glory and all this authority, for it has been given over to me, and I give it to anyone I please. If you then will worship me, it will all be yours." Jesus answered him, "It is written, 'Worship the Lord your God and serve only him.'" Then the devil took him to Jerusalem and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here, for it is written, 'He will command his angels concerning you to protect you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone.'" And Jesus answered him, "It is said, 'Do not put the Lord your God to the test.'" When the devil had finished every test, he departed from Jesus until an opportune time. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Thank you. Please be seated. Beloveds of God, grace and peace to you in the name of the Holy One. Every year, the first Sunday in Lent begins with this story of Jesus being driven by the Holy Spirit into the wilderness. Every year, no matter which gospel year we are in, this is the first one that we start with. It's a callback to the first Sunday of Epiphany, where Jesus is baptized by John and claimed as God's Son, the Beloved, in whom God is well pleased. And last week, just to ensure that we remember this naming and claiming, God repeats it during Jesus' mountaintop transfiguration. But just as Jesus has been filled with the Holy Spirit and claimed as God's own, he's driven into the wilderness to find out what it means to be the Son of God. Now, Jesus hasn't chosen the wilderness, and I think it's safe to say that most of us wouldn't choose the wilderness either. Although, like, and to be clear, I mean like the wilderness, like Survivor kind of counts, right? Naked and Afraid, or Alaska, the Last Frontier, or Man versus Wild, right? Like, I'm not talking about RVs or car camping or those sorts of things, which are fantastic. But this is like literally being out in the middle of nowhere with nothing, right? How many of us would really, truly, deeply choose that? Right? Maybe one of you are like, I know, I see Ken being like, that's not too bad. Right? But no, most of us do not choose the wilderness. We don't choose it, and yet we do know it all too well. We know how it feels to be alone, forgotten, unsure of ourselves, pushed beyond our breaking points. We know pain, suffering, and loss. We know what it is to be beyond empty. Jesus experiences these things too. The season of Epiphany may be over, but the God revealed in Jesus Christ is the God who knows our pain and suffering intimately, because he too has bore it. And while he has not chosen to go into the wilderness, he is intentional and receptive to what God shows him during his time there. His 40 days of prayer and fasting prepare him for the tests the tempter brings to him. His choice to be open to God's grace shows us how to turn toward God in our own trials and tribulations. Our own season of Lent mirrors those 40 days Jesus spends in the wilderness. These 40 days will try us and test us too, especially if we have chosen to be intentional in our wilderness journey, in our repentance and fellowship and prayer practices. The world tempts us and tests us with the lies, though, that we can't do any of this on our own. Right? Self-reliance, y'all. It's the American capitalist Christian way that we do not need God to be made whole, that we do not need the Spirit to fill us up. The tempter in Scripture lies to Jesus about what they can offer him. The devil presents wants as needs, falsehoods as truths, distrust as faith. That if we rely on ourselves, we can do it all. It's a lie that a lot of us, myself included, can be really tempted to believe. But where we falter and fail, where we struggle and rebel, where we cannot accomplish anything apart from God, Jesus Christ, God's beloved Son, succeeds. The one who is tested in the wilderness is the same one who God has claimed as the beloved. And it is in Christ that God's new life is made available to all of us who cannot do it on our own. Even in the desert, Jesus expands our definitions of a full life, even where it seems like there is no fullness to be had. It's not the life that the tempter presents, which is a life defined by excess power, control, or being in charge. Jesus sees beyond this facade and says, even in the midst of his fasting, that one does not live by bread alone. Excess is not abundance, but Jesus shows us that there is more, that there is a fuller life we are called to live, that even in the midst of struggle, of oppressive forces, of hardship and grief, that God's promises spill over like the bounty of the first fruits from the ground, that even in the desert we are called to the riverside to be washed by grace. We do not choose the wilderness, but through Christ we are reassured that God has filled us to the brim with the fullness of the Holy Spirit. That even in the desert, God is with us, strengthening us for all that the world, all that the devil throws at us. That even in the desert, God gives us unimaginably bountiful new life. Amen.
As we sing this next song, I'm reminded of what Amanda just told us in our first reading here. To believe with our hearts, not necessarily with our minds. Let's think about that as we sing, Lord, have mercy. Please rise as we are. Church, sharpen its proclamation of the word so that your people learn to reject voices of deception and distraction. Strengthen all who are tempted to believe lies about themselves or others. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
We pray for the earth and all its creatures. Protect wilderness places and all plant and animal species that call them home. Sustain farmers and all laborers who work the land and harvest the fruits of its abundance. Merciful God, we pray for the nations of the world. Awaken elected leaders and government officials to the needs of those who are oppressed, and grant them compassion to deal mercifully with immigrants and refugees who reside among us. Especially bring a peace to the resolution the Ukraine and other war-torn areas. Merciful God, we pray for those in need. Rescue those experiencing mental illness or contending with addiction. Ease the anxiety of those who live with dementia. Command your angels concerning all who are sick, especially Letty. Lord, walk beside her as she battles pancreatic lung cancer both. Heal our bodies and also heal our hearts. Merciful God, we pray for this assembly. Bless those who bake bread and prepare the table for our communion celebration. Accompany those who share the bounty of this meal with those who are homebound or hospitalized. Keep safe those individuals at risk of traveling to bring care to others. Merciful God, we give thanks to those who have died. Gather them with all the saints into your heavenly dwelling place. Encourage us with the promise that all who call upon your name are saved. Merciful God, accept the prayers we bring, O God, on behalf of a world in need, for the sake of Jesus Christ. Amen.
I invite you to please be seated as we bring our offerings of time, talent, and treasure before God, and to thank Katie for sharing her time and talent with us this morning. Thank you.
Sherry, can you help?
Thank you.
invite you to please rise as you are able as we pray for all the ways in which we give. God of the wilderness, we give these offerings in gratitude,
rejoicing in the abundance of your gifts to us.
We give these offerings in faith, trusting that you will provide for our needs. We give these offerings in hope,
knowing that you can use them to spread your love in this world.
And with these offerings, we give ourselves.
May we live with generous hearts, with open hands. Amen.
Things, I just want to make a little note. We are using the full to the brim worship resources this season, and they have a words for worship. So if things look a little different, we're making use of a new resource. So that's why there's some things might be slightly different. Beloved, the Holy is with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to our God.
Let us give thanks to the Holy One, our God.
It is good to give God thanks and praise.
God, who knows us, we are amazed by you. Your love never runs out. Your hope never runs dry. Your joy never gives up. We wish that we could be more like you in that way. In a world that loves scarcity, your abundance is shocking. In a world that knows fear, your joy is compelling. In a world that knows anxiety, your peace is captivating. We long for these things. As we long, we remember that the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took the bread, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant shed in my blood for you and all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." And the bread and wine that are your very self, show us a life of expansive faith. Show us a life of overflowing joy. Show us a life of absorbing beauty. Show us a life of engrossing purpose. Show us a life that is as honest and rich and meaningful as the one Jesus led. God, we are amazed by you. Your love never runs out. So bring that never-ending love here. Gathered together as one, we pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. I invite you to please be seated. Friends, you are invited to this table, each and every one of us, with our doubts, our fears, our scars, our joy, our dreams, our hopes, our questions. We are invited to God's table. And here we will be met. Here we will be fed. Here we are given a taste of an expansive life that is full to the brim with love and overflowing with joy. So come. Not because you must, but because you can. Come. You are invited. This table is for you. A couple of notes for you all. We will continue to do communion on all of one side and then we will invite the other side to come up. There are baskets for you to dispose of the wine and juice cups in at the end of the front row. All are truly welcome at this table, but if you do not wish to receive communion today, you are invited to come forward with your arms crossed in front of you, and I will ask if you would like to receive a blessing. And also, if you have, if it would be easier for us to come to you, we would be most happy to bring the table to you. So please just let Debbie know if that would be your preference today. All are welcome. Thank you. beloveds of God, may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. We pray. Gracious God, we thank you for this mystery in which you have given yourself to us. You have fed us your word, the bread of life, rescued us from death, and offered us the empire of your grace. Having fed us the bread of heaven, lead us always to turn from worldly powers and desires to embrace your love, to journey from death to life. In the name and the company of Christ. Amen. As we go now from this time of worship full of the Holy Spirit, we may find ourselves driven to the wilderness. But we do not go alone. God goes with us and before us and sends us now with this blessing. As you leave this place, may you be awestruck by the beauty of this world. May you laugh and may it be contagious. May you overflow with love for those around you. May you be effusive with hope and quick to point out joy. And in all of your living and breathing and being, may you find yourself full to the brim with God's Holy Spirit. And may it change your life. In the name of the lover, the beloved, and love itself, go in peace, full to the brim. Amen.
As we leave here, let's lift up all of our troubles to the Lord and let him take them.
Thank you.
Jesus meets you on the way.
Thanks be to God.